What's up, everybody? My name is Bo Tyler. I make music. This is my studio, and today I'm gonna let robots mix my music. Cause I mean, like, I don't have anything else going on, so. Baby, we all know that music is a powerful tool. It can make us happy, it can make us sad, it can even change the way we think. But what about the future of music? Will AI-assisted sound creation be the end of all that? Will it replace humans altogether? Is this all just a simulation? Has the war between humanity and the machines already been fought and lost? Okay, admittedly, that's a bit much, but will AI ever come far enough to replace humans altogether? I mean, probably.
Oh, that was depressing.
Okay, but what if we get to the point that we no longer even need instruments altogether, or computers, and mass landfills are created only to be filled with discarded monitors and motherboards of the past as we achieve the inevitable next step of human evolution only to be able to create the music within our own mind? I mean, I'm just saying, that kind of sounds awesome, right? But seriously, what if there was a way to utilize AI to assist us in the creation of music that is beyond our current wildest dreams? Music that can make us feel the emotions we've never even felt or experienced before. Isn't that the point of music?
Checkmate.
Those are valid fears as well as encouraging optimism, but despite whether this is the holy grail or the tip of the sword to the dark arts, I'll simplify it all by just saying this. Calm down. We're just making a beat. Let's just use it, dive in. I'm gonna use Neutron to help me mix a song, courtesy of my new friends over at Izotope. And it's gonna be a banger, because I got an idea, and I'm gonna teach you some stuff along the way. Let's get it. All right, in today's video, I'm gonna make a quick demo beat and use Neutron 4's Super Brain to help me mix it. And by the way, the AI is literally named Assistant. Naming your AI Assistant is like naming a dog, Dog. The only thing worse than being named Dog, if you're a dog, is being a human being whose name is Bob. Your parents didn't name you Robert, they just named you Bob. Poor kid never had a chance. Anyway, now that we're all on the same page, let's get into it. I'm gonna start with keys or pads. I'm still super high on 40's very own keys. It's a plugin I reviewed just a couple weeks ago. I'm still in love with this one, so I say we start there. So this is actually a tweak on a preset I was working with the other day. It's giving me serious vibes, so I just say we roll with it. And also, I mean, if you like the way that this sounds, here's the settings. They're all yours. I was thinking lo-fi hip-hop, you know, when I started playing those sort of muffled chords with the slow attack, but I've been listening to way too much Harry Styles lately. His new album is The Truth. If you haven't heard it, don't judge me. You need to correct your misunderstanding because he is an absolute genius. Oh my God. Because of that, I think I'm gonna put a dancier, more pop sort of beat behind this, and I actually have the perfect sample from the Neon Splice Pack. I've had this drum loop that I have been sitting on for a while. I think this is gonna be the perfect time. Check it out. I would record the bass next. I usually just do that right after the drums so that you can go ahead and confirm the groove. But I have a very specific idea of what I want to do with the bass to help spice up the chord progression. So let's go ahead and jump out of the normal box and record guitar first. And ultimately, this will help develop the vocal idea, which is starting to take shape right up here in my brain box. Yeah, So if you're a regular of this channel, then you already know what's next. Let's do bass stuff. Long overdue, you all have asked, and I'm going to share a little bit of theory for my fellow nerds out there. It's easy to get stuck in a rut when it comes to bass, and kind of simply always approach the instrument as though you are obligated to play the root of the chord. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm going to do that myself quite a bit, but one trick I like to utilize to keep a four-chord progression from getting monotonous or repetitive is to alter the chords by changing the bass line. As opposed to being a musician, when I have my producer hat on, I don't tend to think of music on an instrument-to-instrument basis. I think of it more as a collective piece of art. So, for that same reason, I think of chords in terms of all of the notes being played by all of the instruments at the same time. If you play an A major 7 chord and I play an A note on bass, we're playing an A major 7 chord. But if you play an A major 7 chord and I play an F sharp, then we're playing an F sharp minor 9 chord. Your musical choice has all the characteristics of an A major 7 because that's what you chose to play. But when I add the F sharp, it changes the overall chord. In future episodes, I'll go more in depth into this topic. It's just too deep of a subject to cover in passing. So suffice it to say that should you ever want to get out of the box with your bass lines, then it's really never a bad idea to at least try for the relative minor, which is just to say, count down three notes from wherever you are. It won't always work, but it will work a lot, and it's an awesome feeling. And just in case you didn't notice, I actually used this trick quite a bit in this song, so let me show you the difference. In both of these examples from this song, I'm playing an A major 7 on the keys. On the first example, I'm playing an A root in the bass line, which keeps it nice and happy and, you know, just what everyone is used to. However, whenever I play the relative minor of A, which is F sharp, underneath that A major 7 chord, it's a much different, deeper, more intriguing feeling, and it actually becomes an F sharp minor 9 chord. Because of this, we can actually grow the context of the music to help support the lyrics as the song moves through time. Guitarist and pianist don't decide chord progressions. Bassists do. It's a pretty powerful weapon if you can embrace it. When I make beats, it's kind of all about the final result, but when I make songs, for a lack of a better term, I like to have a little bit more skin in the game, and since I didn't make the glorious beat going on in the background, I'm gonna go over to my trusty percussion stash to spice it up, and thanks to my friends over at Sweetwater, I've got a few more weapons to try out. We'll judge them, and if you like them, links are in the description below. So yeah, let's get weird. I need to clean my desk. Okay, so I have quite possibly way too much percussion gear from cajones and extra drum kits and everything that's in my spare garage. And while I have plenty back here that I've been using over the years that I've collected from multiple continents and all over the US while on tour, seriously, never pass up a local percussion shop whenever you're traveling. I'm a big believer that it's just such a great way to spice up a mix and make it uniquely you. So I've got a few new ones here though that I'm super pumped about, all courtesy of my friends at Sweetwater. The links for all of these will be in the description below, and I'm definitely gonna do another video very soon where I build a song almost entirely from my little percussion stash. I think I'm gonna take my Jeep and go somewhere fun and try to get out of the studio. This first one I wanna show you is a brand new Kalimba. I've had one for a while and just haven't been crazy about it, mainly just because of the quality of that Kalimba. This one's 50 bucks, Sweetwater sent it over. This is the Minel Percussion Sound Hole Kalimba 17 note Acacia. The next thing they sent me was, I thought, ridiculous. I didn't ask for it. I kind of gave them a list of things that I thought would benefit you all. And my guy surprised me. A wooden frog, Guiro, medium African brown from Minel. It's $25. The amount of sounds you get out of this is crazy. I'm gonna call him Frederick. Everyone say hi to Frederick down in the comments so he can feel welcome. This thing is crazy and it's my favorite thing they sent. I know, right? It's crazy. I'm like a little kid with it. You're my new buddy. All right, anyway, let's keep going through these. I've got a lot of different shakers, a lot of different types. Some of them are very exotic sounds that I might go to more specifically in certain situations, but these are my all-time favorite shakers. I like an egg shaker. I like all shakers, but these can't mess up. They've got a good grip, good weight, and just shake them. Shake them towards the microphone. Okay, so the last thing I'm gonna try to add to the drum beat and what I'm looking at right now is this fancy little bag from Zildjian. As you can guess, they're finger cymbals. I have no idea if this is the right way to do it, but basically I bend it in half, stick them through, and that didn't work. Nope. I have no idea if I'm doing this the right way. Somebody tell me in the comments. Got it! So these little things may seem ridiculous to you, but they're not. I have used these over the years so many times in other producers' studios. I'm so glad I finally have them. Let's jump in here. Let's isolate the drum beat and maybe just add the bass groove to it. And we'll add some percussy things. Is that a word? Doesn't matter. Let's make music. All right, that was absolutely way too much fun. And I seriously believe that every producer should have a percussion box in their studio to help bring their songs to life in a way that's unique to themselves. I've linked all of my favorite percussion gear, not just the stuff that I use, down in the description below, courtesy of my friends over at Sweetwater. So seriously, do not sleep on the frog. Frederick has so many different sounds. And yes, his name is Frederick. Okay, so before we record vocals, I want to shape the mix just a little bit. I like to have as clear of an idea of the vibe as possible before singing because it helps me shape the way I approach the vocal. I can tell you that I have a very, very good idea of what I want to do vocally, and I'm getting super excited about it. So Neutron 4 from Izotope is an all-in-one plugin suite for crafting a super professional mix, quick and easy. Neutron actually does so much and has so many creative uses that I'd need to do an entire series of videos to perform a proper tutorial. I'm not gonna derail my creative process right now, so I'm gonna be showing off its mix assistant feature. I'll tag some other dope videos that go into the other features that other content creators make, but let's go in here and add to the guitar as an example. Then off camera, I'll go further and add it to all of the instruments and give you the before and after to prove my point. Here's what it does. All right, so this is the guitar part without anything on it whatsoever. And all I'm doing to get that guitar is I'm running the guitar through Guitar Rig 6 into my favorite preset called Atmo Git. And I've made some small tweaks, but this is one of those presets that if you turn it on, it's gonna sound good. The only other thing we're gonna put on is Neutron. So let's do that right here. And we'll do mono to stereo because I recorded it mono. All we're gonna do is press this button and now we'll press play. So there it is, it's mixed. And I think it sounds pretty good. I want to punch it up just a little bit. Let's add a little bit of distortion to that. And since I only recorded one guitar part rather than doubling it on the left and the right, let's turn up that width and we'll get this. So here it is without any Neutron. All right, so now I'm gonna go ahead and just add this to all of my channels. I've already done that off camera. Just gonna turn them on right here and we will be good to go. All right, I'm not going to show you the vocals in context with the song until the end of the video, because you know we always do a little performance at the end, and I want to save that surprise. I think it's going to blow you all away. I do want to show you, however, the before and after on my main vocal line with and without Neutron. The difference is crazy. And the fact that I was able to do all of this in about 2 minutes max is even crazier. Now, full disclosure, I do also have CLA vocals on those channels. I just love the CLA vocal compressor. I love to put it on the wall setting and max it out, and then I just know that my vocals are gonna be level. So it's there at the beginning of the chain just for that. There's no reverbs, delays, any of that stuff on there. In this situation, it's just for compression. Okay, so I don't think I need to have a long, extensive outro here. I believe my point has been proven. Clearly, AI is dope and we should just trust it in all things.
All hail the algorithmic overlords.
Seriously though, I still don't know how I feel about AI, but I think we can all agree that Neutron is pretty dope. In the end, I don't have enough money to pay mixing engineers to work on every single song I make, and I would like to spend more time making music and less time mixing it. Now I know that's some people's cup of tea, it's not my favorite part of the process, and I mean, who's with me? So anyway, if you enjoyed this content, please be sure to like, subscribe, smash the notification bell, all that stuff, and please drop me a line in the comments below. Nothing helps the channel with those algorithmic overlords more than a what's up and a thumbs up. That was pretty smooth. I didn't mean to. But yeah, mostly I just like making new friends who are fellow music lovers. But that's it for me. My name is Bo Tyler. I made music and here it is in its entirety.